Why are rear wheels dished? I know it's because of the space taken up by the rear cassette. But why not just make the hub narrower, and not make it asymmetrical? Sure, the drive side hub flange must be moved inboard to make room for a big cassette. But why not move the other flange inboard as well? The spokes must be at an angle to provide lateral stiffness to the wheel. However, the wheel must be in static equilibrium, so on a dished wheel with different spoke angles on each side, the drive side and non-drive side spokes must be in different tension, or else have different diameter or spoke count. This is well known. But why go to the trouble? Why not move the non-drive side flange in as well, and use the same spoke tension on both sides? Suppose on the drive side, the spoke flange is offset 20 mm from the hub centerline, but on the left, the flange is offset 40 mm. Obviously, 20 mm of offset is sufficient offset for the drive side, in order to impart sufficient strength and stiffness to the wheel. In fact, I postulate that the larger offset of the non-drive side is unable to add additional stiffness versus the 20 mm offset of the drive side because the wheel must be in equilibrium. Any additional offset of the non-drive side must be compensated for by looser spoke tension, anyway, giving no benefit. So why not just make it 20 mm on both sides, and reap the benefits of a shorter, stiffer axle? It cannot be true that dish provides a laterally or vertically stiffer wheel. The wheel must be in equilibrium, so the stiffness of a dished wheel should be the same as a wheel where both flanges were simply the same distance from centerline as the drive side. In other words, the drive side is the limiting factor. The only advantage I can see to dishing is that the lower spoke tension on the non-drive side might allow thinner, but longer, spokes and thinner hub flange, saving weight. But this seems unlikely to compensate for the weight savings that could be had with a shorter axle. Another possible reason is an aesthetic desire for a laterally symmetrical frame dropout spacing. But in a world of lefty forks, is this really a barrier? I thought of this after seeing a heavy-duty touring bike with an undished rear wheel.
The bicycle wheel by Jobst Brandt touches on this. Enter image description here. Some rear hubs that have done a version of this include the Ritchie Zero or Z hubs. The Road Zero hub had a 21.3 mm center to right flange measurement and 28.6 center to left, so combined with a 3.65 mm or so offset rim it was dishless. It didn't need an asymmetrical frame, but moving in the left dropout is secondary to whether this sort of idea can work. These wheels do function and didn't seem to have any grievous reliability problems, so maybe they should have been copied more, but they also don't push the concept all the way to total symmetry. I believe the deal with this is that there are some physical reasons why if you take the center to right flange measurement off a road hub and say, okay, if that's strong enough for lateral loads in one direction, then let's make the left one the same, you wind up with a wheel that buckles easily from lateral loads in either direction. In other words, it's not just a matter of what bracing angle is good enough per side. In the highly tensioned disparate wheels we have, the better bracing angle side is somehow making the whole thing more stable. I haven't done the deflection tests that would be needed to test whether this is true, but what I have done is build a number of SP generator hubs with their dainty 23.5 mm per side center to flange dimensions. Those wheels have the unlovely trait that when you do routine side loading on them to reduce spoke windup, you can feel that they're extremely laterally flexible, and it's easy to induce a column buckling type failure if you're not careful, something I have no trouble with in other wheels. People ride them and they work, but from what I've experienced it's clear to me that once you're down to bracing angle numbers like that on each side, the wheel threatens to become too unstable. Another piece of the puzzle is that, as with so many aspects of bike component design, competitive and sport use is the economic backbone of the industry and so what works there drives what gets made. How it applies here is that existent rear road wheels have been strong enough for competitive use under athletic riders, so doing anything about their lack of strength from being so heavily dished has never been seen as a priority by the mainstream, or worth compromising anything else to fix. Virtually no advantage is ascribed to increasing the strength of the wheel against vertical loads, so why sacrifice any lateral strength to get it, even if it were just in one direction? Were this not the case, offset rims would be ubiquitous, because they work against the problem in a manner that gives up nothing other than some additional costs, and have become common on prefab sets.